Yes. Today we are going to discuss about a few theories. What are the theories in corporate governance? Okay. Most probably we will be following the two theories, but there are actually technically four theories are there. So please understand the concepts. The challenges of corporate governance and the ethics is, so if you go to any books, mean the book will give more and more details. That much is not required for us actually. So please try to understand the concept. And please try to note down the key points. Anyway, the slide will be shared, but please clarify if there is any doubt. And then go for searching for any book. If you go for first, if you start reading with the book, means you can't able to understand because it will be vast in the clarifications. Okay. So we started discussing about what is corporate governance, what is corporate, what is the need for a manager, CEO, who is powerful, shareholder, stakeholder, like that we start discussing. Okay, these are our general discussion, but as per the law or as per the code of conduct, there are some definitions based on that our corporate governance are running through. So when you starting the organization, if it is a small organization, if it is a SME, if it is a single ownership, then have some liberality to take over the business to the next level. But when you when your business goes to a public share limited, okay, so when you are going to get the money from the public in any way, so that's a share issue, means at the time the government will influence you to maintain some standards, because you are obviously has to be listed in SEBI, you are under the control of SEBI if you are issuing the shares. That's why many corporates are not registering them as a corporate. They want to run as a small entity itself even their turnover is hi. So here the subject is mainly clarifies when you become big, when you expand your business, when your turnover is becoming high, you have to register as a corporate. And if you are going to list in the SEBI, in the shares or top 500 companies, mean then you have to follow some criteria. So for this, there is some explanation you have to understand. Theories of corporate governance. The first theory is agency theory. Second theory is shareholder theory. Third one, stakeholder theory. So mostly we will be discussing about agency theory and stakeholder theory, or sometimes agency theory and shareholder theory. The last two, stakeholder to some extent and stewardship, it will be a rare question, but as per the subject you can learn what it means. So when we want to discuss about who is powerful, who is important, and why we have to decide. So later we are going to make a combination of board of directors, why the board of directors is important, even in the board of directors, who is powerful, who can be given a more power. This is the common issues we will have. So as I said, when you become a corporate company, means there is no word called owner. Okay, you can become a major shareholder. So for example, 30% you are collecting from public, means you can claim you as a 70% major shareholder. So you cannot be a owner, you can be a founder. That means at that time another 30% people have the right to ask you the question, and when they are investing in the shares, you are answerable to your plus and minus, and there will be a growth of the company, there will be a degrowth of the company, but anyway you are answerable to all the shareholders, even the public and sometimes the government. So you have to frame organization structure. So normal simple organization structure, we will speak about CEO, MD, HR manager, finance, but these are all only for the administrative purpose. Okay, so it is for the delegation of the job, it is for a decentralization, it is for dividing, it's for communicating. That is completely different. Okay, so hierarchical structure, organization structure, that is completely different. But when it comes to the corporate governance, you are answerable to the entire stakeholders. Structure, organization, this is only answerable to within the company. It's an internal control. But when it comes to the corporate governance, whatever the structure should be justified by some people because they are answerable to the public or shareholder. So we have to know what is agency theory, what is shareholder. So each theory will contribute different theme. So from that we have to adopt some concepts when you are going for corporate governance. And another thing, there will be two approach that we are going to study. One is rule based approach, another is principle based approach. That we will again see. So first make it a simple agent. So we have to understand the two words. One is called as agent, another one is called as principle. So if it is agency theory, you have to remember the two words, principle and the agent. So principal means normally we know principal means important. So here owners. So owners are otherwise called as principal. So who is the owner? As I already told that in company there is no actual word called owner. So who are all investing the shares? They can be called as owners. So the principal or the shareholder. So what is the another name we can have? Who are all the shareholder? They can be called as a principal. So who are all the employees? The employees mean not all the employees, the managerial employees. Okay. So here we normally use the word called the manager, executive, etc. But in a corporate governance, we have to call them as a director. Okay. So but here for a simple term, we are mentioning as a owner who is owning the company and who is managing the company. That means employer and employee, like that we can take. In the employee, we are taking only the higher official. So the agency theory tried to explain the relationship, how the relationship is important between the principal, that is a shareholder, and the manager. He is otherwise called as the agent. So here we have to consider what is the role of the principal. The role of the shareholder is investing money and expecting profit. What is the role of a manager? Is he has to ensure the profit is happening. So the principal shareholder gives the money, invests the money. The responsibility of the manager is give back the money to the investor. Okay. So these are the expectation. Okay. So on behalf, so owner or shareholder is investing the money. What he expect? Return on investment. But the manager is working more. So what he will expect? He will expect for salary, allowances. Because he is an employee, right? So we have to balance both things. Both are working for some return. Shareholder is working for the profit and returns, and the manager is working for his salary. So how we have to balance. So in terms of agency theory, it is a group of concepts describe the nature of agency relationship. What is the agency relationship? The relationship of the agent. Who is an agent? Director is the agent. So here we are using a word called director, board of directors. Okay, director is the agent. And who is the principal? Who invested? They are called the shareholders. What is the so agency theory speaks about the relationship between these two people, agent and principal. Okay. So the directors, we have some other word called executive members or executive director. These are the technical word we are using. We won't be using the name of manager. Okay. So an agent, director, or executive member is employed by the principal. So shareholder is otherwise called as principal. He only recruit directors or executive member. Here we are called as a director. Director is called as the agent. Okay. So this director has to report to the shareholder. Okay, principal. So he is accountable. So some keywords are very important here. Accountable. Accountable means at any point of time the principal can ask question towards the agent. It's a director. That's the relationship. And director have in reverse fiduciary duty. Fiduciary duty means you are giving me salary, so it is my responsibility to work for you. That is my moral responsibility. That is called as fiduciary duty. Okay, it is a moral duty to work for you. So the director has a fiduciary duty to the shareholder. So that is called as a principle of the organization. Okay, another word we are calling as a stakeholder. So shareholder who invest. Director who works for the principal or the shareholder. Who are the stakeholders? Stakeholder are any person who get affected positively or negatively by the performance of the organization, by policy of the organization, change in rule of the organization. So he can be a shareholder, he can be a supplier, he can be anyone who gets affected by the performance of the organization. So director, shareholder, stakeholder. So agency theory speaks more about the principal and the agent. Principal is a shareholder, agent is a director. Okay. So here, why we have to discuss two things so before going to the next thing. So director is actually getting salary. Okay. So he has no responsibility or no commitment about the organization above certain level because he is not investing. Maybe the director is lying there for 5 years, means the sixth year, he has no responsibility, has no commitment about the performance of the organization. But shareholder, he has to wait, he has to get the return from the organization. So he will be so much bonded than the director. So how the director has to be appointed, how the director has to be remunerated. So when we speak about remuneration, so remuneration of the director. So there is a two challenge. So if time permits, we will discuss later. If the directors are given less salary, what will happen? The director always started looking for some other job, or he may not be interested, or he may not be involved in the improvement of the organization. Correct. So normally what they will do, they will link with the incentive. So whenever the organization perform, there will be incentive. So if the director is not getting proper incentive, if the director is not getting proper perks, allowance and salary, he may be dissatisfied. That is one argument. Another argument is, you have to give a normal salary. Whenever the director performs well, the company will perform well. Based on the performance, we have to increase the salary. That is another term. Another person is telling, if you give more and more salary, means he will be more satisfied, he will become loyal. Another person is telling, if you give more salary, he will be satisfied with the salary. He will not be looking for more any other benefit from the company. So his attachment towards the target will be less. The same case, whenever there is another case in the HR, whether we can give a more salary or less salary. The same thing happens here. So it is again very big challenge what to decide. So we are having some other committee. Later we are going to discuss some other committee to decide what should be the salary of the director, what should be the responsibility of the director. That is also is a very important factor. Okay, so here the agent personal objective can be a desire for higher salaries, larger bonus, etc. But for the principal, principal means the shareholders, wealth maximization. So we have to balance both objectives. And this is repeated. Yes. So the first theory, agency theory, speaks about two important words, director or agent and principal and shareholder, what will be the relationship. So director has the right to choose strategies more beneficial for their own interest. So director has the power to choose how to merge, how to acquire, how to do the business. He had given a full right where to invest, how to the source of money. So if the attitude of the director is not okay, then there will be a problem in managing. So this agency theory speaks about the relationship and how we have to balance a director and shareholder relationship. Okay, with the agency theory. Next one, shareholders theory speaks about we have to give more importance to the shareholders. So shareholders are the investors. They are actually looking for the maximum return from the money. The owner, they are otherwise called as owner. Okay, it's a return on investment. And managers are the directors. They are paid to ensure the things are happening. And the role of executives or the director is to maximize the wealth of the shareholder. So the shareholders are the higher level. This, according to this theory, the shareholders are the higher level because they invested more. And the employee as a manager or a director, they are working under shareholder. So the roles and responsibility of the director is to ensure the profit is happening. And the agent means the director should be faithful to the shareholder. So the shareholder theory says that the entire process of the corporate governance should be focused on the shareholder, because if the return is coming, automatically the company will grow. And the director should be under the control of the shareholder because he is just an employee. That is one theory. Okay. So third one. Stakeholder theory, it says, so stakeholder, as I said, it includes creditor, employees, customers, suppliers, and even the local community, government, auditors, consultancy, etc. Who are all get benefited or who are all get affected by the company, they are called a stakeholder. So here we are adding a value, stakeholder includes shareholder, stakeholder includes director. So we cannot think director is so powerful, or investor, or the shareholder is more powerful. In the corporate governance, we have to take care of the stakeholders. So we should not focus only on the investment return. We should not only focus on the authority of the director. So we should be. Yes, some text is coming. Fine. So we should be giving equal importance to all the stakeholders. So different stakeholders are of self-interest. Again, so when we have to decide these things, again, that's another question. So for example, I will go back to the previous slide to show. Creditors. Creditors means who gave money for us. They are actually looking for the interest, banks. So what is the expectation of a bank from us is they have to get the return as an interest. So they won't be looking for growth of the organization. Yes, technically, if you borrowed some crores of money means you have to pay lakhs of rupees as an interest. That's it. Their commitment or their involvement on the companies, they have to get back the interest. If you settle the loan, again, they wish to give the loan. So that is their role. What is the role of the employees? What is the interest of the employees? Employees, even they are working for the company, even they are looking for the welfare of the organization, the final thing is they want to get a salary. They want to get an incentive. They want to get a bonus. Yes. So they are so committed. So even if you say HR manager, the HR manager will be committed only to the HR department, taking care of welfare of the people. So when we say HR manager, he will take the welfare of the people. I mean, he always try to give more salary, more benefits, etc. to people. So he may not be worried about, he may not be worried about other things. Okay. So a HR manager will look for the welfare of the people. Shareholder, because shareholder is also stakeholder. Shareholder won't bother about anything. He needs return of money. So if the shareholder is looking for more return means, he always wish the director to reduce the cost. If you say HR, he will suggest the HR manager to reduce the salary. He will try to reduce the incentive and bonus. So the objective or interest of the shareholder is only money. HR manager, his role is only to take care of the employees. If I say marketing manager, his role is only to sell the product. It's just to sell the product. He won't bother about what is the cost. He won't bother about what is the profit. He won't bother about the future things. So when we say, if for example, again, supplier means he wants to supply the raw material. Whether you are producing it, whether you are selling it, whether you are getting a profit, it's none of my business. So I want to sell the product to you as a raw material. If you are giving money, I'm happy. So every stakeholder has some restriction or they have their specific interest within the boundary. So if I want to consider one person objective means I have to compromise other person objective. If I want to give more salary to take care of the employees as per the instruction of the HR means I have to sacrifice what is expected by the finance department. If I want to satisfy the stakeholder called the customer, I have to give a product at a good product, which in the good quality, but lesser price. To create awareness, I have to give more advertisement. Yes, so marketing, I have to satisfy the customer. If I so much worry about satisfying the customer, I cannot satisfy the shareholder. So there may be some mismatch. So stakeholder theory says that we have to take care of, we have to balance. That means that it's a balance. But obviously, you know, there will be a lot of challenges. We cannot satisfy all the people. So what can be done? So later studies, we see appointment of directors, appointment of committees. That is the role we are going to study. So stakeholder theory says that we have to satisfy all the stakeholders and everything is for long-term interest. It's not for short-term. Sales is a short-term. Increasing the employee salary is a short-term. Giving a return to the shareholder as a dividend is a short term. So we have to look for the long term benefit of the organization. So these are the for your information, I just put the slide. These are all the different stakeholders. So in the stakeholder theory says that we have to take care of all this interest of the stakeholders without affecting the organization performance. Another side, we have to take care of the organization performance also. Yes. So as I said, in terms of stakeholder, mean that again there will be a claim. So claim means requirement. Yes. So there's a word called stakeholder claim. Is where a stakeholder wants something from the organization. As I said, a customer will look for different thing. A supplier will look for different thing. Shareholder will look for different thing. Okay. So in this also there are two different of claims. Because the requirement demand is called as claim. Direct claim. Sometimes the stakeholders directly claim something. Okay, so for example, if we say employees means the employees may form a trade union. Okay, they may be forming a quality circle. they have a groupism, they have a right to demand some salary or allowance, whatever the issue. So that would be some direct claims. So you should know how to deal with these trade unions. Another side, there is an indirect claims. Indirect claim means sometimes here it is mentioned as a customer. The customer is facing a problem with the product or a retailer, but he don't know how to communicate. And as a single customer, if the problem is for 1 rupee or 2 rupee, nobody will listen to that customer. Even he is putting a case, there will be a lot of restriction. He has to go again and again. So in company, there will be some people, they are powerful, they know how to claim, how to do a direct claim of the problem. There are some stakeholders like customers or other public who have voiceless, we call this a voiceless. They have no energy and no power to claim it properly. But stakeholder theory says that we have to find out their problems and we have to resolve, we have to make them satisfied in all the perspectives. Then the last one is a steward theory. Okay, it's called as just a minute, friends. Just please hold on. So next one is steward theory. Steward theory, here we steward, the meaning of the steward is guardian. Okay, so it says that all the managers or the employees or the employers should act with the sense of guardian for the company. So they have to take care of the company, they have to take care of the stakeholders as a whole. They have to take care of all the resources. Okay, so steward theory is a very simple theory. It says that all the people should take care of all people in the organization, including the public, including the shareholder, including the other employees, managers, CEOs, etc. So these are the four theories. So again, to remind again, the first theory speaks about agency. Agent means a director. Okay, so here it has to be maintained the relationship between agent and the principal. Principal is the shareholder. So we have to balance the relationship between the agent and the principal or shareholder and director. That is the first theory. The next theory, second one, speaks about shareholder. It will speak more, it will give more importance only to the investors. So it says that we have to consider the return on benefit of the investment from the shareholder point of view. Third theory says that no, it's not like that. We have to take care of the managers, we have to take care of the employees, we have to take care of the suppliers, we have to take care of the customers. All are important. The fourth theory says that it's a stewardship. Yes, if you are going for a corporate governance, it is a responsibility of the managers and also the employees and also the company. As a company, a corporate company should guard all the people, including other dependent or independent persons. So it's a stewardship theory, but mainly the first two theories are important. Okay, so this is one big question. You have to remember what are the theories of corporate governance. Next, we have to check what are the approaches of corporate governance. So here, as I said in the last class, we can deal the corporate governance in a two way: rule based approach or principle based approach. So mostly we adopted this corporate governance concept from the two different countries, US and UK, and sometime we will adopt some things from some other Asian countries and European countries. But mainly here we are discussing about two approach: US approach and UK approach. So before seeing this slide, to understand it easy, US, this corporate governance always speaks for principle, rule. It's not this principle. They have a separate set of standard means that has to be followed by all the people. Rule based approach means the rule is common for all. Even you are having a small organization or a big organization or a corporate organization, even you are in automobile industry or FMCG industry, even you are located in a small village or even you are located in a big urban city, the rule is applicable for all. Whether your business is 100 crore or 100 rupees, it applicable to all. That is called as a rule-based approach. Starting from the investment, starting from the acquisition of the raw material, starting from the accounting system, starting from all other corporate governance formalities, you have to follow the rules and regulations, irrespective of your constraint and challenges. That is called as rule-based approach. It is adopted by US. So US, if you go for seeing the company, means all the company has to maintain certain record. They have to have a common disclosure. But when it comes to a principle-based approach, means it is adopted from UK. So UK corporate governance claims that we cannot have a common rules and regulation for all type of company. Even for the same company, we cannot stick onto the same rules and regulation. So for example, in today's COVID scenario, we should have a different set of COVID related corporate governance compliance. Compliance means finally we have to submit a report. So for example, last year, the government also given an exemption to extend the date for paying the tax. But if you go with the rule, mean irrespective of your business, irrespective of your laws, you have to stick on to the rules and regulation mentioned by the government. So this UK principle-based corporate governance approach says that it can be a flexible, it has to be case-to-case basis, it depends upon the situation. That's it, simple. So that is mentioned here, okay? So there are two approach, rules-based approach, it is adopted from US. So this adaptation is done from the few of the earlier things we called as the Sarbanes-Oxley Act 2002. It's from US, okay? So they adopted this. This is adopted because of some scam happened in the country. So for this, they said that it is a requirement for law for all types of business, all types of corporate governance. So we have to adopt it. So that's a set of checklist. So the corporate governance has to evaluate. And it is mandatory for all types of company to follow. So there are some advantages of US-based, rule-based approach. Okay. So here there is no choice of ignoring, okay, so I can do this. If I have money, can I go for exemption? No, it is common for all. So as it is common for all, the investors or the shareholders will feel comfortable or feel secure or feel confident. Yes, if somebody started the company, if the company is listed in this shares, we can confidently can invest because it is listed, it is following rule-based approach. The government has the right to pick them if there is anything wrong. What is the disadvantage? Sometime if there is any particular challenge, even the challenge is very valid, the government still, it has to interfere. It won't listen to, as per the law, it won't listen to the problem. They have to stick on with the payment or other things. And negotiating the remuneration of the director, deciding. So for example, remuneration, we are saying that remuneration, as I already told that remuneration of the director, if it is high, then again, he will become lethargic. If it is very less, then he will become demotivated. But the US-based approach says that there will be a common platform for fixing the salary or the remuneration of the director. But as a company have an innovative policy to motivate the director or other innovative policy to control the director means even I am innovative, I cannot adopt the remuneration policy, what I wish to. So I am in hold, I just want to follow what the government says. These are the some disadvantages. So this is Sarbanes-Oxley Act 2002. We adopted from this with respect to the rule-based approach. When it comes to principle-based approach, it is a corporate governance adopted from UK. Single set of rule is inappropriate. It clearly shows that case-to-case basis we have to consider. Situations will differ with the company to company. And the people to people, investor to investor, time to time. And in terms of disclosure, as I said, the compliance, in terms of rule-based approach, irrespective of your organization size or the type, you have to give all these details, maybe 500 pages or 600 pages, irrespective of the size of the organization, type of the industry, all you have to give the same type of compliance report or annual report or a financial. That may not be required, but you have to give. But when it comes to UK-based approach, it says that you have a flexibility to say. There are some important things like financial statement you have to give open to the public. But there are certain things there is no need to explain. For example, appointment of director, remuneration of director. So if you want to keep it as a personal, you can keep. So it is a voluntary disclosure. If you want to disclose the information, you can disclose, otherwise it's not required. Because some company will feel something has to be disclosed, something should not be disclosed, so that the shareholder will invest more shares. Means this second approach gives some liberality to take decisions whether we can disclose or not. So it is flexible, as we can say, we say flexible. So UK Corporate Governance Code says that there are 5 sections you can decide. In the compliance, in the management structure, in the corporate governance, you can follow or say about the leadership, what type of leadership you can have. and you should say about the effectiveness or the performance of the organization, and how much the individual people are accountable, and what will be the remuneration. Remuneration has to be fixed. That can be decided by the internal things only. And what is the relationship with the shareholders? As I said, relationship with the director and shareholder. So these five code they mention. So in the corporate governance code, you have to explain about these things. And again, it is not compulsory. You can have your own flexibility. So these are two different things. So it is already said that US corporate governance adopted from Sarbanes-Oxley Act 2002. And with respect to UK corporate governance, they adopted from three committee: Cadbury Report 1992, Greenberry Report 1995, Hamel Report 1998. There are some interesting case studies behind it. So, but we are not going to discuss it now. Okay. So each committee or each report is formed based on some cases they faced. So based on these three say in specific, UK corporate governance codes are formed. So now we come to India. Have we made? So we have a mix of these two. So India, why it is highly adaptable globally means we want to pick up whichever is best from whatever the rules or regulations or the corporate governance is followed in the different country. And with respect to the legal aspects also, we are ready to adopt from any other country which is suitable for our country. So here we can say corporate governance approach, we are following rule-based approach. Yes. So that's why our share market is stable, our banking is stable. So comparatively, any other country we are seeing that we are having stable structure. Even during the inflation, we are able to survive. So because we have some rule base, we are not completely flexible for all the business person. And with respect to the shareholder, UK corporate governance says that we can be an independent director. So independent director, so you will say, what is between independent director? He can become a shareholder. But US says, when you invest in some shares of the organization, you cannot become an independent director. So dependent director is different, independent director is different, that we'll see later. So norm says that as per the US, if you are going to invest some money in the organization, means you cannot become an independent director of the organization. That is the rule we are following, but we are not following UK. With respect to the audit committee, so we are having a number of committee, right? Audit committee means UK says only independent directors, so who have no regular role in the organization, can become audit committee. But in terms of US says that minimum three people should be from independent directors. So if you say dependent director or normal director, mean they should walk within the organization, they should be involved in day-to-day activities. Independent directors mean they will be out of the regular business, they will come then and there. They will see from the outside view. So US committee says that minimum three independent directors required. But UK says that only independent directors. India decided two-third of. So for example, if we have a 30 members, mean at least 20 members should be from independent directors. So there is a mix we decided based on our system. With respect to the remuneration, UK discourage all forms of performance related remuneration. US allow stock options. So there are two things. When you want to encourage a director, you can give more incentive, bonus, etc. But UK says that performance-based remuneration should not be given to the director. That means performance-based means if the company is performing well, the company profit is growing more, the company is allowing many people to invest more, the company is acquiring many things, then we can say the director is performing well, then we can give more remuneration. UK says we should not do this. If you do this, mean the director will try to find out a ways to accelerate the actual performance. So we should not link the company performance with director remuneration. Director remuneration should be independent. US what says that if you want to encourage the committee members, mean you can have the allow stock options. Stock option means you can invest. For example, instead of giving more incentive and allowance to a director, I can say some amount of share will be given to the director. For example, 1 lakh rupee means 70,000 I will give as a salary, 30,000 I will give as a share. So what the US feel is, when the stock option is given, so he will become a shareholder also. He has some responsibility apart from a director. Whenever the company is growing, whenever the company is getting more dividend, more profit, mean he can also enjoy more. So 70% he will get the regular salary irrespective of the performance. Balance 30% is based on the company performance. So he will manage he will balance both the general management also the financial management. That is the concept of US. The same thing is adopted by India. Next one is whistleblower protection. Whistleblower, the concept whistleblower means if something happening within the organization, mean some person will say about, they will leak about the problems, they will share about the issue, that is called as whistleblowing. So when we come to UK, if somebody is acting as a whistleblower, means somebody is sharing that this thing is happening, the complaint, they are doing some problem, they are doing some misbehavior activity, they are doing some illegal activity, means that person will be taken care by the law. And the US says that strong protection law in place. Yes, both says, US and UK says that if there is some whistleblowers or that, they are helping the organization, they are informing about the illegal activities, mean these people can be taken care by the law. But in India, we are not having that much protection against the whistleblower. That's why many issues, many internal things are not disclosed openly. Okay, so this thing is just a comparison of two approaches. This you have to learn, US approach and UK approach. US approach is a rule-based approach. It cannot be changed time to time and company to company. UK approach is principle-based, based on the situation to situation, based on the performance, based on the company, based on the employees. It can change. India, we are taking certain things, we are removing certain things, we have our own independent. So this is our Indian approach. So these are the two approaches we have to learn. The models of corporate governance, this I will share. This again, with the same four countries, you can learn about this. So overall, when we come to Indian model of corporate governance, so with respect to the designing of, so for example, you are going to start a company and you want to make it as a corporate, means you are designing a corporate governance. Means with respect to the Indian model, you have to consider the, at least the two theories, okay, shareholder theory or agency theory. So either you have to focus more on the shareholder or you have to more focus on the director's role. That you have to decide. So from the theories you can understand. And with respect to the Indian model, we can have four models of founder families who initiated the business. They have some role. And public sectors, they have some role. Widely dispersed shareholder company, mostly by the investors. And so what we call as MNCs. MNCs means there is no shareholder from the separate country. There is no owner from the separate country. It is a globalized. Okay, so we can get more managers, more employees, more machines, more technology, more investors from all over the world. That means it's the MNC. We cannot say this country or that country is having a overall control. Okay, so these four different things will be dealt by Indian model of corporate governance. Okay. So as I said, the corporate governance is a system by which how the company is directed and controlled. Okay, so here we have to understand what are the place we can give control, what are the place we can give the responsibility to these two people. One is called as a principal, another one is called as agency. Otherwise, one person is called as a director of the organization. We generally we call it as a manager of the organization, but here we are calling it as a director of the organization. Another one is called as an investor or shareholder of the organization. So this concept will discuss. So I will try to move on to the next one with the continuation. So before going to the committees, so next class maybe we have to discuss about the committees. What are the various committees? So we are not giving entire power to anyone. So friends, please confirm whether the PPT is visible.
No, sir.
No, sir.
Sir.
No, sir.
Just a minute, please. Yes, now, please.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Thank you. So as we discussed about directors, here this slide will explain about what is board of directors and what is the need for committee. Maybe in the next class, we'll be discussing about importance of various committees. So simply corporate governance will try to explain us. We cannot give the powers to any one people, either the shareholders or directors. We should be very careful. We should have a different setup to control over. If anyone did a mistake, that should be automatically controlled by others because we are answerable to the shareholder and also the public. Okay, so here we will see a few definitions that might be known to us earlier, just for revision. So who is a director? Director are someone who directs the business in the path towards his vision and mission. So we use the word called a manager, but in the corporate, there is no word called a manager. Manager will come only taking care of the particular departments or any functions. So director is the core person who is heading or directing all the people. So again, the board comprises, here again, not only one director, a board of director means it's a group of directors. So it should have a suitable number of directors so that the business will be taken care of. The board's role, board of directors' role is to provide entrepreneurial leadership of the company. That means that even we have a 5 board of directors or the 3 board of directors or a 10 board of directors, all the 10 directors should act as an entrepreneur of the organization. We will call the word called intrapreneurship. So the managers or board of directors are called as intrapreneurship. Why means even they are not invested the money, but they will take care the company as their own company. They will take the full responsibility. And they have the right to invest. They have the right to expand. So as their own business, the board of director has to feel the company as their own company. And they have to work for the welfare of the organization. So that is the board of director's role. And the major decisions, including acquisition, including joint venture, or how much amount we can borrow through banks and how much amount we can get from the share. These are the key decision has to be taken at the top level. We normally use the word called top level. Here we are using the word called board of directors and committees. Okay. So these major decisions will be taken care by the board of directors only. And all the board of directors, it said that they should be accessible to the all reliable information, irrespective of any department, starting from the finance, starting from the marketing, HR, whatever it may be, the board of director has the right to ask about any information at any point of time to verify whether everything is going on track or not. Okay. So here director, we have another word called the shadow director. So shadow director means they are not formally appointed. Some companies may have a shadow director. Directors, they occupy the position as a director, but sometimes some companies for some reason will make directors as a dummy directors. And they will have some other shadow director. They are not actually appointed director, but they will try to influence the director. So there is a word you have to understand. The shadow director, the people in accordance with whose instruction the directors are accustomed to act. So it might be for some positive reason also it will happen. For the namesake, for shareholders' view, for the employees' view, I will be appointing one director who is familiar, who can influence other people. But backup, I will be having another shadow director who is not coming in figure, but this director has to follow only this shadow director's information. That is called the word called shadow director. So what may be the duties of the board of director? Yes, they have to constitute the structure. What we call this organization structure, right? That proper organization structure has to be designed by this board of directors. The entire success of the organization is dependent upon the board of directors. Whenever there is a judgment or decision has to be taken, they should take an independent decision. Even there is a common decision has to be taken. So I should have my own view, you should have your own view. This views has to be considered that finally the decision has to be taken. And there should be a reasonable care, skill, diligence on the organization, employee, shareholders, etc. And always the board of director has to try to avoid the conflicts among stakeholders. Stakeholders mean common board. So they have to avoid conflict among the employees, among the shareholders, among the directors, among the committee members, even among the customers, even among the suppliers. So they have to frame some policies to avoid conflicts among them. And the main important thing, they should not accept benefits from third party. So the board of directors can get some remuneration from the company, from the remuneration committee, from the HR, but they are not allowed to get money from third party. Third party may be another company. Okay. And all the board is accountable to the shareholders. So one side we said all the board of directors can access to any information from any department. Same time, the shareholders mean investors. If I am an investor, means I have the right to question, yes, you are a director. What is the role you are doing? What is your roles and responsibility? What is your day-to-day activities? What are the meetings you attended? What are the decisions you made? I have the right to ask director. So why this discussion is, we cannot give more power to any one of the people. If anybody did mistake, mean another person should be automatically adjust the situation. So the board of directors is accountable or answerable to the shareholders. Okay. And another thing, the accessing to the all the information they are given with the rights, but at the same time they should not disclose any confidential matters about the principal. Principal means shareholders, about the company, about the agreement what we are having, about the contract we are. So they should not disclose anything about the organization secrets to others. Okay, so apart from this, what are the roles and responsibilities of the board of directors? They can have the company view, they can create a company vision and mission, they can appoint a chairman or CEO. So board of directors are 5 or 6 members or 10 members. So for them, there should be a lead, there should be a leader, there should be a common person. They are called, they can be called as a CEO or chairman. So please understand, the CEO or chairman can be a part of board of members or can be outside the board of members. That has to be decided by the board of directors. So till now we heard a CEO as a very powerful role. It's not so. The CEO can be appointed, can be remunerated, can be apprised, can be questioned, can be sacked by the board of members. So board of members are so powerful. So the company should take more time to decide about the board of members. Okay, and they should set a standard company values, and they should decide about how the internally the controls has to be taken care, and how the risk can be managed. We are going to study about risk management committee and how the financial items, human resource items. So technically we are saying all the departments, a major decision has to be taken care. What are the duties of the each function has to be explained by the board of directors. Okay. So in the board of directors, we have two divisions, executive director and non-executive director. Shadow director is completely different. They are not at all a director. They are a suspense director or hidden director. They are not a directors. Okay, but directors, we can have two different types of director, executive director, non-executive. These are the 2-mark question, or it will come on 4-mark questions. What are the roles and responsibility of the executive director? What are the roles and responsibility of non-executive director? This thing will come. So executive directors are active and they will involve in day-to-day management of the company. Non-executive directors may not be involved in day-to-day activity. And usually the directors will get remuneration as like a full-time employee because they are daily coming to the company. They will be monitoring also. They are actually an our part of an employee. And they have a dedicated their work life to the fulfilling the duties as directors. So they have a lot of responsibilities. They have a lot of duties to perform. And they are responsible for relieving any queries, relieving or appraising any conflict happening in the organization day-to-day basis. Non-executive directors can be a full-time, cannot be a full-time. They should be outside the organization. Non-executive directors cannot be a part-time or full-time of the organization. They should be outside the organization. Whenever there is a requirement, at the time only they should come. What is the whenever? When we want to do a consulting. When we want to auditing, what is auditing? Internal audit and external audit. We are going to study in the next unit. Internal audit, I can check. Okay, HR manager can check about the marketing manager. Marketing manager can go and check about the financial performance. Our finance department will make a check about their clerk, other things. This is the internal control, internal appraisal. But if I am getting an auditor, why we are having an auditor? Even we are having a finance manager, even we are having a financial assistant, we are having an auditor because auditor is a third party. He won't favor the organization. So whatever the tax or other document filed and approved by the auditor is accepted by the bank, is accepted by the government. Why? He's a third party. So non-executive directors can be outside the organization. They can come for audit. They can come for fixing the remuneration. So for example, internally, if I'm putting some person to fix the remuneration of the employee's bill, there will be some bias. Even I am not biased, there will be some feeling of partiality among the employees, there will be some conflict will happen. But if you call somebody from outside, they are called as non-executive directors, they come, they will conduct some interview, they will fix up the salary for the director, and then there will be no problem. Whenever there is a risk is happening, I will try to think about the risk on my own perspective with my own experience as a board of director. But if somebody from outside, they have a contact with many companies, they have a discussion with many companies, so they will have their own view, that is right. A nomination. So whenever we are recruiting, whenever we are appointing board of directors, there will be some number of people can be from outside. And these non-executive directors have a broad view apart from the financial thing. They can think about the society, they can think about the ethical code, they can think about the culture. So in terms of board of directors, that's two different types of directors are required. One is executive director, that is for essential functioning of the day-to-day activities. And another one who can be from the outside the organization, that is also required. Always we should have a third party supervision or third party corrections if there is any problem. Okay. And another thing, non-executive director should be independent of the business. Already we said he should be out of the business. He should not be a shareholder. He should not be a director. He should not be an employee. Another thing, you should not be a family member. And you should not be any other relationship with the company person itself. I cannot say I am an uncle of, I am a brother of, I am a daughter-in-law of so and so. No, they should not have any connection with the, or even in the relationship also. And they should be independent in thinking and approach and actions. So board of directors, they have their own team. They can discuss, they can debate, they can come with a conclusion. But always it encourages that the non-executive, so it is other word is non-executive or independent director. Independent or non-executive director has the right to think on their own way. So when we are in common discussion, they have their own views, you have your own views, finally some we will come with the innovative solutions. And they should exercise independent judgment. Whenever there is a decision has to be taken, whenever there is a judgment has to be taken, they should not feel about the employee, they should not feel about the director, they should not feel about the company itself. They should tell us like a judge, us like a court judge. He won't feel about anybody. He won't feel, so he will just listen to all the person, he will just give the final legal decision. The same way, the independent or non-executive director has to be independent in even in the decisions, even in the suggestions. Okay. And again, the functions of non-executive directors can be with respect to the financial informations. They can check whether the financial explanations done by the company is right, and they can interfere on remuneration. So they can question why the salary is more, why the salary is less, and they can try to understand the views of the investors. So they have to speak to the shareholders, and they should find out the opportunity to attend the meetings. So another responsibility of the non-executive directors and independent directors is whenever there is possible, they have to come and discuss with the employees, discuss with the shareholders, discuss with the internal board of directors to understand what is happening in the organizations. Okay. So overall, what is their role? A strategic role. They have to plan for the future growth by giving advice or managing a challenging situation and scrutinizing. What is scrutinizing? Recommending or filtering or appointing directors, executive directors. So the executive directors can be appointed with the suggestion of the non-executive directors. And if there is any risk is involved, if the internal control they are unable to manage means, then the non-executive directors can influence the decision with respect to the risk management and with respect to other, as I told, people role. So strategic role, scrutinizing role, risk role, people role in terms of appointment and remuneration with respect to the appraisal, these things also can be suggested for the executive director by the non-executive or independent directors. Okay. They have the full influence, and we are going to study about various committees in the next class. Remuneration committee, how much salary can be given, that is one committee is there. Nomination, how to recruit the director, there is one committee is there. How to audit the information, there is one committee is there. So likewise, we have a number of committees. In all the committees, few members should be from non-executive director. Few members or maximum member can be from the executive director. So internally, we should have some director. Externally, we call as a non-executive or independent director should be there. So this is the structure of corporate governance with respect to the directorships. Directors, non-executive directors are different. So when we have a non-executive director, it has its own advantage and disadvantage that we will discuss later. And this is one case of Cope Steel model. I will show the slide. So how the organization, we heard about organization structure, but here you can see how the structure is designed with respect to the board of directors, compliance committee, independent director, non-executive director, like that. It is shared in this slide. Okay. So with this, I can stop today's session. Okay. So maybe in the forthcoming session, we'll be discussing about various committees. Okay. Various committees. And if possible, we will try to come up with a case for discussion. Okay. So if there is any doubt, students, you can have the feel to switch on your videos, and I will take the attendance from the Zoom account. So another one, so I request the students to be in formal dress, because sometimes you'll be called to at the time you should be properly dressed. Okay, so I request all the students be in the proper form. So I am unable to see a few students. I will check with the Zoom. So okay, students, thank you for the great day. So we will discuss maybe from the Monday. Thank you all. Have a great day.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.